Today, what we are going to see a very different and a very specific type of problem. But before going to start and talk about the solution for that problem, let us first understand that problem. It's actually slightly different than classification. So suppose that if I have an image like this, say I'm having m rows and n columns, m cross n image I have. I take this image and give it to my network. My deep CNN network, it will take this as a, you know, then it can apply to 2D convolutions, and then it will do some pooling, then it will do some 2D convolution and then some pooling, and at some point of time you will get a small feature vector which you actually flatten, and then you do some fully connected network, and at last you are going to get a final final classification, and over that you apply the softmax. And last layer, suppose that we are concerned about the cat and the dog images, or maybe there are five different classes, and then I will say that last layer is going to be having five neurons, and that's going to be a softmax, and you are going to get the probability related to the given such image. What is the probability by which it is actually cat or dog or this or that and this and that? Yes. So this is a typical way in which a classification network is actually working. And there are so many different types of available classification network. Few of them are like AlexNet, VGG, Inception, ResNet, and then upcoming complex and bigger networks for classification. I assume that this is okay, clear, and completely understood to each and everyone. Now let us understand about a problem. Before the understand about this problem, what this network, what is the responsibility of such a network? Responsibility of such a network. The responsibility is with respect to given task. With respect to given task, my network has to somehow extract such discriminative features that with respect to task as well as the given data set. So if I say that whatever is the task and with respect to this data set, it has to understand that I need to come up with the features which are discriminative. And once I get the discriminative features, I am done. And I just need to upcoming images, I just need to find the same feature and give the final classification. This is the responsibility. Now let us understand a problem in which I am having a bottle like this, and it is having a lid of blue color. Then I am having another type of bottle like this, which is having a lid of red color. Now I am going to have two such classes. And this is my class one, all the images, maybe 10,000 images of this class and maybe 10,000 images of that class. Network is being shown these 10,000 images one by one. And this is my class zero, this is my class A, and this is my class B. If I train any type of network, let us ask someone that if I train any type of network, what do you feel that Vaibhav, what type of features that we are going to get? Vaibhav, what type of features network is going to understand or learn?
Sir, here we want to try and find bottleneck of the problem.
Yes. So it will say that this bottle lid, it will understand initially it is seeing all that stuff. But at some point of time, it understands that if I look here, Everything is same. I am not able to differentiate between these 10,000 images from these 10,000 images. At some point of time, it started to say that if I see something over here, if I see something over here, and then later it understand that I just have to see that what is the, you know, pixels over here and what is its color. What are the pixels which are over here and what is its color? Not the shape, but the color. So color of you know, these things and the lids, it actually understand at some point of time. Okay, so this is what a classification network is doing. Now let us talk about another type of problem. So this is actually the classification problem, and in this classification problem I will say that network need to understand that there is something, you know, really discriminative, and for that, and okay, and let us see this network as another type of network. This is actually classification network. We have seen this thing and understood the inception type of network. Now let us see another type of network in which I am having a tree like this, I am having a house like this, I am having a maybe a car like this. And this is my image for you. And then what happened that Anushka understand that the problem, I said that, can you tell me that what is inside this image? So Anushka understand that there is a way to somehow find out that something is here. Something is here and something is here. So you all understand this problem is actually an object detection problem in which you understand whatever the things which are being there and what are they. And once you understand that, Anushka says that there is a car, there is a house, and there is a tree. I said that no. So this is actually object detection. This is for this problem when network is trained. For this problem, object detection networks, when your network is trained, it is completely trained in a different way. This was inception or something. And this was FRC, NN, YOLO, SSD, and different networks. So when these type of networks are being trained, they are being trained in a completely different way. You all remember that type of network, how they are being trained. Now the point is that what type of things that they are going to look into the network? Are they going to find out these type of leads or the discrimination between this and this? No, they are trying to find out the objectedness. What type of close boundaries by which we can somehow come up with the object. And once you come up with an object, they will try to understand that what are they. So they are trying also to do the classification, but first doing the localization. So classification plus localization. So they have to look inside each and every image. Each and every image they have to look inside and figure out that what is that object. They are being trained and they must have to realize that what they are looking, because they have to report this. These are two types of network we have seen, and then we have seen generative models. But now let us talk about another type of problem. This type of problem is completely different, and this problem is most of the time being easily shown in, say, Dainik Jagran paper or Times of India, or maybe these type of paper. I'm sorry, something is happening. Yes, so they used to show you image in which probably you are having two halves. Exactly same image is being shown here. And here also exactly same image is being shown, and you need to somehow tell that so now you need not to tell that whether who is this person, where is this person, there is one person or two person, there is a TV, there is whatever thing which is being left. Now the question is completely different, and they used to ask, can you find out 10 differences between? And the whole thing actually depends upon that whatever you are training, whatever is going to be the network in which you are interested in, you have to train that network in order to solve a specific type of problem. And depending upon your problem or the task in your hand, probably you will have to design and train your network. So again, if you see this, then the network was inception or some type of network. If you see this, again, FRCN and SSD, inside they are using a very similar type of, say, inception or VGG or something, but training process got changed. Network remains to be the same, but the training process got changed. Similarly, if we come over here, the problem is changed. Network that we are going to train is again going to be very similar, but the training process is actually changed. A different type of training is going to be applied. What type of training is going to be applied? And that is the thing that we wanted to understand. First of all, when I show you such images, do you really wanted to know or interested that what is this? No, you just see that this is going more in, this is going less. You wanted to see that if this is in this direction, what is point, why this is pointing in this direction, what is the meaning of this, you are not bothered about. You want to say that this is pointing in this direction, this is pointing in the other direction. Then you will say that this leg is bigger than this leg. Then you say that it is having a square in the center, this is having the square in this direction. It is saying that it is in this direction, the arrow is here, there is no arrow. And in this way, you try to find out 10 differences. Why you wanted to find out 10 differences is the question that we are going to solve now. And these type of networks which are being trained somehow to understand the difference between two images, it is going to be identification/matching networks, and they are being trained. They are actually CNNs, but are being trained in a CMEs fashion. Let us take few questions if there are any, and then we will go formally to see this network. If anyone is there who wanted to ask any question, or it's very easy for everyone right now. I am assuming that it is easy, and let us go and and see this. So it's a yes.
So why can't we directly compare the pixel values?
Yes, that's a very good point. And I was expecting that few of you please ask. And that's my, again, a question that I usually give time. Please ask questions as simple as possible, as complex as possible, so that I also got to know and got some time to answer these things. Suppose that I'm having two images, image number one, and I have image number two, and this image is actually of my own face. And this is also of my own face. When you take this image, if you exactly at the same point of time, you take and you take selfie of your own, and in the same time you take another selfie on your own, and then what you do is that you take this and convert it into JPG. Those who know, this JPG is a lossy transformation. It will convert each and every pixel. So this pixel is my eye pixel sum, and the value is 254. Maybe in next time, exactly in the same next time frame when I have taken this, the same point if I take, the value may be 253, maybe 252. Exactly same values are definitely not going to come. But even if they are very similar and close, we are not here to solve the exact matching images, because it doesn't, you know, it's not going to be a real problem. Real problem is that today you take my selfie, and next day again you take my selfie, and today right now I'm having beer, next day I have clean shave and having a cap. How can you differentiate between them? You need to, and if I show you these images as a human being, very easily you can differentiate between them. But network, if it's being trained like, you know, pixel level differences, there are huge amount of pixel level differences. If I just switch on a light and switch off before taking two images, one in light, one in less light, images, I mean, your pixel level or any other type of, you know, normal strategy is not going to work. If images are not properly aligned, that is that I have moved my head slightly in this direction, alignment is being lost. So pixel level things definitely are not going to work at all. But there are other ways using traditional machine learning they used to try to come up with a rotation invariant feature, which means that if I rotate an object, whatever the features that I have got, they should not be changed. Similarly, illumination invariant features, everyone is interested. If you wanted to change the illumination of an image, our assumption is that the feature that we have got, they should not be completely different from the features that we have got in the completely or huge amount of variation, huge amount of illumination when it is there. Is this answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let us talk about another point as you have asked, that illumination variation is definitely going to be there. Now let us see an image, and there is some, you know, structure like this, and there is some light which is coming in this direction to this point. And then you have, and there is the camera, and camera is looking in this direction, and this is the light source. So you have exactly same, everything remains to be the same, and light is on. And then you take image number one, that is my image number one, and then light is off. And then I take image number two, I off. Exactly same. This is actually an object which is lying on my table. It is a 3D object lying on my table. This is a real 3D coordinate system, I mean 3D location of my light. And similarly, this is a 3D location of my camera. I have got two images. Do you feel that both of them are going to be very similar type of features or the representation, or it is going to be difficult, or variation is huge between them? Can you tell me?
So there would be some, there would be differences.
There is going to be huge amount of differences. Now the question is that, can you tell me a simple way by which you can counter or come up, or I take this and send it to some transformation, I will get I on transformed image. And then I take the same net, I mean, I take this image, second image, and transform it, I got TI off. So I have got a transformation, some you know, function that will take my image and take it to a transformed domain. In that transformed domain, we want that I on and I off should be very similar or equivalent. Can you tell me a simple such transformation? Everyone is able to understand the question, or should I repeat? Let us answer. I mean, let us take it. Yes, you all understand the question?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So we can please, take.
Sir, we can.
Yes,
take
one by one. Program. We can do it. Wait. We can do it one by one. First, who is going to say? Please raise your hand. Prateek, you was there?
Yes, sir.
Prateek, first you tell.
Sir, histogram equalization.
If you do histogram equalization, we will talk about this. Others, there was someone else who also wanted to say something. Please say.
So same histogram equalization.
Okay. See, histogram equalization, if you do, you are changing the color and you are trying to equalize the histograms, and it's not going to be that the histograms are exactly going to be remain to be the same. But yes, that is one approach by which you can somehow convert both of them into a very similar looking histogram, and that is a global net, global transformation. Anything else that you can say?
We can, like, from the daylight image, we can subtract a mean pixel intensity to bring it to a normal value, or in the image with darker pixels, we can add some value to bring it to a mean value.
Yes, this is perfectly correct. Can you, how can we find out what to add and what to subtract? This is not easy, because it's going to be dependent upon light. How much amount of light was being thrown, and depending upon that, you have to estimate and add or remove. So this is going to be difficult to estimate how much to add and how much to delete. Actually, that is the question. How much to add and how much to delete? Yes, anyone else? Aap bataiye, otherwise I need to ask. Please, anyone can say.
Sir, maybe take a white paper or something like, and click a picture and then find difference.
So white paper, if you take, then what's going to happen is that most of the values are going to be close to be 255. Because it's actually white, most of the values are going to be 255 or may not be 255, maybe 240, maybe 230, and you have got that value, got it average and subtract. See, this subtraction business is very difficult because you have to have a reference, as Rohit has said, that you need, or Anushka or everyone was trying to say, that you need to have a reference. You need to have a reference image. How can you come up with a reference histogram? How can you come up with a reference image? How can you come up with a reference white intensity or the black intensity? But tell me that, are you really interested in these intensities? What is the real thing in an image in which you are really interested?
Set the object.
So how to get these objects out? Not applying object detection, by the way, because I am asking few simple things right now so as to aware you and setting up the tone. Things. Yes, Anushka, tell me.
So basically, to get the object shape, we first need its outline.
Yes.
So its boundary, like its borders, its outline, the first would be its shape, basically.
Yeah. How to get the outline? Yes. You are right. You are in the right direction. How to get the outline?
So where there is change in the brightness or intensity, there will be the outline, the probability, yes, of the outline.
How to get the change?
Adaptive threshold कर सकते हैं सर
image. We can do adaptive. Wait, one by one. We Anushka, I am coming to you. Anurag, you have said that adaptive thresholding. Again, this thresholding is going to ask you, you know, that what is going to be max or min with respect to that you wanted to do some sort of thresholding. So if you threshold in such a way, huge amount of information you are going to lose. Yes, Anushka.
Saying for getting the edges, we can see the gradients in different, yes, directions.
Yes, that is the main thing that one should have to. So if you are looking for, and that is very simple for you to understand the fact that intensity got varied. Fine. Just understand that if intensity is changed, it is not an abrupt change which has happened. Intensity is being changed and throughout the whole image is actually getting less or more intensity. And if everyone is being affected by the same thing, gradient remains to be the same. Those who were rich before COVID, they are still rich. Few of them actually have lost. So COVID is being affecting each and everyone in a very similar way. Maybe to the businesses, it is, you know, affecting huge. For the salary class, it is not affecting in that way, but affecting in different ways. So let us see the same thing which is happening in the image. If your pixels, you know, there was a ordinal relationship between pixels, which means that some pixel was having high value, some pixel is having low value. The values are being changed. But those who were rich previously, they are still rich, richer than the one to whom they were, you know, having more money. Let me show it in this way. Like if I say that I'm having a pixel over here and I'm having a pixel over here, its value is 249 pre-COVID or maybe pre-lighting condition, and this value was 200, this value was 37. Now both of them got more intensity. So in the next image, this becomes maybe 255 and this also becomes high, maybe 137. Values are non-linearly added, but their ordinal relationship, you can see that ordinal, or you say that the relationship between the who is having higher value. This guy is having higher value still. And if this type of things are going to happen, you know, you are actually looking for something which is actually called as gradient, because gradient between them is still there. There is still a boundary between them, rich and poor. After COVID, there is still boundary. Rich becomes, you know, poorer. Poorer becomes slightly much more poorer probably. But there is still a boundary between them. Nobody is earning more than Shah Rukh Khan still now. Nobody is earning, you know, better than Virat Kohli still. even though they are not playing, even though they are at the losses, if you just choose, this is Virat Kohli and this is some, you know, normal person, his wealth is also going down, this wealth is also going down, but still this guy is richer. And is that is the thing is happening. There is a gradient, there is a line between them, there is a boundary between them. And if you can find out this boundary, those things, if your lighting is there or lighting is not there, no light or light, or no light, you cannot do anything. Low light and high light, in these cases, gradients are actually working. And if you really see those who have visualized in between the networks, that given any network, if you visualize that what type of things it's actually learning. It's actually learning things very similar to this. Low light and high, so intensity difference, gradients, and what are the directional gradient. Now, gradient is only telling you one thing, that there is some difference between them. Can you tell me that what is the direction of the gradient? Gradient may be sometimes in this direction, maybe in this direction, maybe in this direction. So first you find out the gradient, then you find out the direction with the gradient, then you find out the other things which are related to gradient, and these are the things which are going to be augmenting each and every pixel and its information related to that pixel, which will make it much more discriminative and robust to different types of image variations, maybe rotation, maybe scaling, maybe color, maybe different things. I assume that I spent plenty amount of time for this, and we all now understand that a few simple things are also being there. But what is the purpose of such a network is that we need to somehow come up with the similarity measures. This girl, we do not know who is this girl. This girl, we do not know who is this. And we wanted to first of all find out that where are these objects, and using different object detection network. But once you find out these objects, is there anyone who can tell me that who is this guy? I do not know that who is this guy. I do not know that who is this guy. How to somehow come up with this? Or if I give you a image like this, first you require an object detection network which is dividing and telling you that, oh, these are some things. But what are they? So there is someone who has said that, okay, this is 8. This is 0, this is 0, this is 6, this is 9. So first you need to somehow come up with the object detection, and then you need to do a type of somehow recognize what is being written. You can see this problem also as a classification problem. But soon at some point of time, I will definitely differentiate this problem as a classification and similarity. There are two different type of problems. As I have said, that when I show you an image, when I show you an image in which you just have to find out the 10 differences between them, you probably may not be interested to really understand what is there inside this ball, what is there inside this. You just have to find out what is the difference between them. Once you only interested to find out difference between them, you need to learn in a very different way. Instead, I said that you need not only to learn what is the difference. Basically, you have to tell me what is this and what is this. Now, this is slightly more complex question. It is difficult to answer. And for that, you require much more information, that can you show me more images of this, or can you show me more images of this, so that I can somehow understand that what is the thing by which I can understand that what is inside this, and how to understand that what does that mean. In this case of this similarity measures or the similarity network, we are least bothered about that what is inside my image. I'm interested how this part is different than this part. Now both of these learnings are completely different. So yes, this is one part in which we are saying that handwriting recognition, recognizing faces. Basically, you are looking for a metric. What is a metric? Metric can actually be a function f of x comma y, which can say that like this, f of x comma y, which can somehow find, or you know, this is a function which will take these two values, two vectors, two images, two different type of things, and tell you, I mean, to both of them are actually having a very similar type of structure, but only in terms of data structure. Other thing, that what is inside this, we are not interested at what is inside it. We are interested how much they are close. It may be a cat, it may be a dog. If cat and dog, both of these images are very close to each other, you need to give me 0.15. If they are very far, you need to give me 0.9, 0.8, 0.92. If they are very close, a small value. If they are very far, big value. That is why it is actually called as a distance between any pair of elements in a set. What is a metric? So if it's actually a metric, then metric has to somehow. So metric, we are actually trying to do a distance metric learning. Several times this is also called as metric learning. We are trying to learn a function. Our network that we are going to define, it is going to be a theta set of parameters. This network F is going to be parameterized over theta. F is going to be the function which we are going to estimate using a network which is being parameterized using these theta parameters. We need to learn these parameters, but if it is going to be a metric, then it need to be somehow following few properties. First one is that non-negative, it always have to be F comma X comma, this has to be, you know, greater than or equal to zero when they are exactly same, or maybe something which if they are very different. Second thing is that it has to be, you know, F of X comma Y is equal to zero, X or Y. So this actually means that if it is zero, then they both are actually similar. X and Y is similar. So that is why it is distance. So sometimes we need to find out the distance metric. Sometimes you wanted to find out a similarity metric. If it is a similarity metric, then opposite is going to happen. If this value is one or very high, then they are going to be same. So sometimes you find out how much difference is there. Sometimes you want to find out how much similar they are. Then it comes on to be the symmetry, which says that if I give X comma Y, it has to be same as Y comma X. The distance between this point and this point should have to be same as the distance between this and this. This is called as a symmetry. Several times this symmetry is not being there. If it is not symmetric, as we have seen in the case of KL divergence, that is why it is not being said as a metric. KL divergence is actually a divergence which is telling how diverge two distribution are, how divergent they are. It's not a metric because X, Y and Y, X, they are not same. And then the triangle inequality, you all understand that the distance between this to this and distance between this is X, this is Y. So this distance is always less than this and this, this plus this. So this one should have to follow. This is the metric, normal metric. What are the traditional approaches? Without using deep learning, some of you are actually trying to say that you can extract certain features like a color histogram, or maybe you can say that we can find out the edges or the SIFT and SURF type of features. Those who are doing CV, computer vision, they may be aware that there are different feature representations in computer vision, and huge amount of work is actually being done in that area to somehow come up with, you know, representations which are invariant to or the robust enough for rotation, translation, coloring, and lighting condition, and so on. So few approaches are there. We're not going to talk about them. And once you have got, you can find out the distance between them using L1. So if you have got an image, you take it to some function, find out a feature, and then you take another image, send it to the same transformation, get another feature vector and find out the feature vector difference L1 or L2 or whatever, so as to find out whether they are very similar or not. Now there is a challenge, and the challenge is that these traditional machine learning approaches in which they first try to find out a feature vector and then do this similarity, similarity between both of them. So the metric is not being learned here. It's actually a fixed L1 metric. Features you may learn using neural network, using some other type of network, you can learn. But when both of these things are being seen, they both are actually being seen as two dissociated things, then they are not being learned jointly. And that is the main sense between any neural network, that if you have feature extractor and you have a classifier, then you train them simultaneously. Along with that, the loss that you are getting here is back propagated throughout, and your feature extractor is also learning from the losses, and your both of these networks are actually cooperating. This is usually happening in classification. Similarly, if I have a feature extractor, then I have a metric that I wanted to learn similarity. In traditional machine learning, this is being trained differently, and this is being fixed or being directly being used from somewhere. If you wanted to train them jointly, you can use a deep learning approach, and that is why you find out a loss. It will say that I will learn here the best possible metric, which is suiting to the best possible feature that you are going to give it to me. That is the thing CME is going to do. The problem statement is that given any pair of images, we monitor how similar they are. How similar, how dissimilar, completely depends upon us. Sometimes I will write similar. Then if I write similar, then if it is same, I have to say zero. If they are different, I have to say one. Real number, or so it can be a binary label in which I will show you in two images and say that whether they are similar, you need to tell me yes, or yes, they are similar, and you will say zero. Or if they are not similar, you will say one. So it can be a binary label, or it can be a score by which you are saying that I assume that they are similar with a score of 0.2 or 0.5. You are having a man image like this, and you are having another image in which the man is actually like this. You say that they are very similar and the value is 0.2. And then I have another image in which I am having a square which with a, you know, four blocks like this. I find out the distance between them and the value is coming out to be one. Is this okay to everyone? If you have any question, then you can ask here. Very simple, no question. Now, let us talk about the CME's network. So I'm having an image like this. I'm having an image like this. This is my I1, this is my I2. I'm having a network which is taking it to, this is my CNN network. I will take this CNN network, show it my first image, I've got a feature, show it my second image, I've got a feature. I merge both of these features here. I merge both of these features, feature one and feature two, into one concatenated feature vector, and then keep on reducing the size, make it a binary single node, and train it. Let us see this problem again. So given a pair of images, we want to find out how similar they are. The output is going to be 0 or 1, and I wanted to learn a function like this, which will say that either it is 0 or 1, or I will say that the distance between image 1 and image 2 is t. I mean, it's less than t or more than t for the same classes. For the same class, it has to be like this. So if they are very similar, the value has to be less than t, and if they are different, the value has to be more than t. And this t then can actually be used as the threshold, that if you, after training, during testing, if I give you any image, you just have to check that these two images, pass it to my d, I1 and I2. If it is more than t, they are dissimilar. If it is less than t, they are similar. Is this okay to everyone?
लेकिन अगर 1-to-n मैपिंग करनी है, कोई डिपॉजिटरी है उसमें काफी सारी इमेजेस हैं और मेरे को मैच करना है, तो वहां पे CME's नेटवर्क इज नॉट अ गुड फिट, ऐसा कह सकते हैं?
Yes, right now I have given you a very simple formulation of such a problem. We definitely need to solve 1-to-n, otherwise it is of no use. Okay. So we are going to extend, and network is going to learn it things in such a way so that it has to understand that thing. If it is not able to solve that problem, my problem solution is useless.
Okay.
Yes.
Sir, so, one more question, I'm sorry. So, आपने ऊपर T define किया था, तो T is defined statically or is it also T?
This T.
So, is it also learned or is it like we define a static threshold?
So, for such things, we depend upon my data set. And given my data set in which whatever the pairs I have, so then I make all the pairs. And for all the positive pairs, I will see and find out the minimum one and choose that thing for my T. Sorry, for all positive, I take the maximum one and choose that thing. So there are multiple ways to somehow come up with this T in biometrics or when you are doing matching. You know, we used to find out something which is called as equal error rate. And the threshold for that is going to be used. But right now you assume that given good amount of data, you need to somehow statistically find out the best possibility for which you are getting the best performance over your training set. And then use that T for your testing set. Is that okay?
Okay, sir. Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Thank you.
Okay. So let us go and talk about our network standard CMEs network, how this is going to be learned. So I am having patch one, or if I say this is going to be my image number one and my image number two, both of these images I have got. This is my network and this is going to be a shared network. New thing, shared network means that this network is fixed. I have got a network. 2D con, pooling to con pool, and then fully connected. Whatever the network I have got, I take that network and place it over here. This is my CNN. And I make this CNN and a copy of this CNN. This is first CNN and a copy of the second CNN. Both of them are shared. Then I take image number one, pass it inside this. Take my image number two, pass it inside this, and I am going to get this and this, and then whatever the feature that I have got, I concatenate, I subtract. So here what's being done is that in the standard CMEs, that DX1 I have got. What is DX1? The feature that I have got after my CNN, the feature that I have got after CNN, both of them, if I pass the same image again, you are going to get DX1 over, because CNN is same. And then you find out the L2 between them. That's the L2 between them. Then what is going to be the loss function? What is going to be the loss function in such a case? Loss function is going to be very simple. Let us see it one by one. If this and this, both of them are of the same object, slight amount of variation, X1 goes in, X2 goes in, same weights, same transformation, different images, different feature vectors, and you find out the distance between them, and that is your DW. You need to make it small. Why? Because they are similar images, the value should have to be as less as possible. Is there a problem with such a formulation? First of all, let us talk about, do you feel that there is some problem which is going to happen in such formulation? Ayush Gupta, can you tell me?
Yes, sir.
What type of problem you feel? Yes. What type of problem you feel in such a scenario? Ayush, can you listen?
Yes. Hello.
You are audible, Ayush. Hello? Can you speak? Yes.
Yes, sir.
What is the problem with such a type of formulation? Ayush? I guess that are you able to listen? then please answer. I assume that he is having some issues. Himani Joshi, you tell me. Himani Joshi.
Yes, sir.
Is there any problem with such formulation?
So, sir, maybe the DW which we get after L2 norm, it is very large.
If it becomes very large, network has to understand how to find these features so that they become as small as possible. But problem is that this is a one-sided loss. Suppose that network try to do, network is like my student, you know. Yes. Networks are like my student. If I give them any assignment, they will try to trivialize it in the best possible way and solve it in such a way so that it becomes the most simplest thing. So network is also going to learn the simplest thing. It will say that he wanted me to get this thing small. If I take this and make it something which is some fixed value, and I take any image and make it and transform it into a fixed value, then both of these things got subtracted and you are going to get zero. That is the thing you are trying to enforce your network to do.
Yes, sir.
Is this okay to everyone? Understood?
Yes, sir.
So that is the problem with such a type of formulation, which is only one-ended. I am saying that reduce it. Fine. But there has to be another thing, that with respect to what one should be reducing it. There has to be something with respect to which I am reducing. So that is why this is going to be like this, that I have similar set of images and the same image, I will place it here or maybe some else. So I am having similar image pairs and I am having dissimilar image pairs. Network is going to see all of them one by one. It will see similar images. It will see dissimilar images. For similar images, value has to go down. For dissimilar images, values have to go up. And what is the final loss? All the positive pairs, you sum the loss. All the negative pairs, you sum the loss. And that is the loss that you are actually looking for all the positive pairs and for all the negative pairs. You keep on adding this stuff. Is this okay to everyone?
So can I ask a question?
Yes.
Sir, I wanted to ask you this, that the weights, we have two separate architectures when we implement it and then we pass it separately.
No. Through. No. This is one architecture.
No, like what I mean is, this weight is shared by both the networks. Same yes. Weight.
Yes.
So is any weight updation when this
only once. Color? Only once. Okay. Okay. Let me tell you, if you want to see in the terms of implementation, it's a different thing. First, understand. I'm having CNN. It's a fixed CNN. Fixed CNN. I take this image, pass it, find out the feature, take this image, pass it, find out the feature, subtract it, and find out the loss and back propagate into the single CNN network. Is this okay?
Sir, by CNN, we only mean the last convolutional part, or there would be a FC network in the last whose values will be subtracted?
Everything. So it's going to be CNN, then CNN, then CNN, and then maybe fully connected. This is the, yes, this is my network. Clear?
So the node,
Yes, yes, tell me.
Sir, so the last, in the fully connected layer, the last values of the, like, the last values which we get of each neuron, that would be subtracted.
No, not for the last value, huh? That will be subtracted, but the penalty made before we apply softmax.
Yes, yes, that I get.
Yes, and then subtraction between them, yes.
Mm-hmm.
The final layer's output over which you are applying the softmax, over that probably that is the feature for you, you subtract.
Mm-hmm.
Is this okay?
Yes.
And yes, that is also a choice. There is also a choice. Let me show you. Suppose that this is my full network. Somebody may apply over here, CME. Somebody may apply features, take features from here and apply, make it a CME. Some may apply over here. Usually it is being seen that you do not go very high in the network, at least after CNN layers. Then you take the fully connected, maybe some fully connected layers, maybe concatenated, few fully connected layers are actually being used for subtracting the things. So it also is a choice, design choice, where to use, but should not be very high in the network, because in the higher part, you are having the generalized feature. The lower part, you are having the personalized features. Yeah, is this okay? Fine. Anyone who want to ask any other question?
Sir, I have another thing with the loss function.
Yes.
The loss for positive pairs should decrease and the loss for negative pairs should increase. But if we sum it up in one loss, then sir, isn't it confusing? Because at the end of the day, it will be just a val. Like if we just add both of them, then in both, like these two losses should be separate or something like that. We cannot put it in one value.
Yes. Probably we will have to add this and subtract this. So both of them are going to be, you know, somehow, if it's a loss, then both of them should have to be somehow decreased. So we take our, you know, this thing as positive and this thing as negative, because positive pair loss is every time going to be decreased. So we'll take this as a positive and the negative of this we will take, and then it's going to be decreased. Is that okay?
Sir,
yes.
Sir.
Yes. Sir, what will be motive to add the negative loss pairs?
Negative loss pairs, what is the motive here? Let us ask someone who can now going to answer. Ananya Shukla, you please tell me. Negative pairs.
Yes, sir.
Why you have added the negative pairs? Here, what is the motive behind adding the negative pairs?
Sir, we would also try to make this difference large. So this thing also has to be considered while defining the final loss function.
But what will happen if I don't use this?
If you do not consider this, then we will be able to come to the point where the similar images will give small differences, but when we'll try to find the dissimilar images, we won't have a defined criterion for that. So we'll also have to take care of it.
Yes, very similar to that. Let me answer it again. That it is very similar to what Ananya was saying. Similar to that, the point is that if we only have one-sided loss, we do not consider this. Network can learn a very simple transformation in which it will take each and every image and transform it into a single value, a fixed vector, and the difference between them will be zero. So whenever you give two images, it will give you a zero value, and it's been learning this thing instead of learning something which is really related to the images which are being shown inside. It will learn a catch by which it can just give them the, you know, two images, learn a fixed embedding. And the reason is that every time you just see that the loss is going to be comprised of the similar images, no dissimilar representation is there. That is why if a network has learned this thing, and as soon as I give it a dissimilar image, it will give the zero value for it. And network is going to say that, oh, your loss is very high. Why? Because it has to be one. It has to be very high. And you are giving me zero. So it has to make it a two-way loss. It should not be a one-way loss. A loss in which only similar images are being shown and you have to make it zero. I will show you sometimes similar image, you will have to make it zero. Sometimes show you dissimilar images, you have to make it one. Otherwise, you can learn something which is very trivial, that whatever is being shown, make them similar same fixed vector transformation. Is this okay, Vaibhav?
Yes, sir. Sir, can we compare this with the triplet loss?
Yes, it's about to come. But it's the simplest version of triplet loss because right now we do not have a triplet. We are having a doublet. We are having only a pair. We are pairing. We are having not a triplet. Triplet is having three things. We will talk about that. Right now we are having only a pair, in which I am having image 1 and image 2. And then I have positive pairs and negative pairs. I am having pairs. I am having positive pairs. I am having this negative pair. The responsibility of my Siamese network is whenever I show you a positive pair, value should have to be as less as possible. Whenever I show you a negative pair, value should be as high as possible. Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
Sir,
yes.
During training, ये पहले से पता होता है कि we are sending positive pairs and we are sending negative pairs.
Yes. So your batch is being made in such a way that your this is your CNN batch is being made in which you are having two images, image number one and image number two. And what is its label? Zero means same. I3, I4, one. That they are different. So similarly, for each and every pair, you have got whether they are same or they are different. And who is matching, who is making this batch? As a programmer, we are making this batch and we are making it in such a way so that we randomly shuffle. Sometimes we show similar, sometimes we show dissimilar images.
Sir, ek sir doubt ye hota hai ki fir isko sir unsupervised category mein sir kyun dalte hain sir?
Unsupervised, the point is that you can take any image. First thing is that CMEs is not completely unsupervised. First of all, let me tell you. Autoencoders are completely unsupervised. Here you require label. Suppose that you have got all the cat images. Then you have all the dog images. You take a cat image, place it over here. If you take any other cat image over here as a pair, this will become a positive sample. Mm-hmm. Or you take the same image and take any dog image, that will become a negative. That is why CMEs is not a supervised. It's a supervised, not an unsupervised learning scheme. You need to know the label at least of the pair. Probably it may be the case that I do not know that whether this is a cat or a dog. At least you know that they are same and they are different. At least this much is required to make the pairs. Yeah, is this okay? Hello? Can you listen?
Yes, sir, we can listen.
You can listen, but probably okay. Fine. Yes. So, yes. Any other question? Okay, fine. Okay. Any other question that you wanted to ask anyone else? I'm going to stop over here. If you have any other question, please ask. Next.
Sir, essentially, we are just finding the difference between the CNN network, right? The output of the CNN, GW.
So let me rephrase it the way somebody was saying that I take an image one, send it to my network D and get a DI1. Now I assume that D is a network. It will take my image I and transformed into another space. And in that space, it's being seen as this feature vector. Then I take I2, show it to my network, get a DI2. And in that subspace, we wanted to see that if they are same, they need to be close. If they are different, they need to be far. So D is going to transform. We are looking for a network which will take images, convert it into some, you know, high dimensional feature vector and project them into such a space where they, if they are similar, they are close, else they are far.
Sir, in this case, why can't we use the VAE, like the encoder part of VAE, and
yes,
we will have then 2 points in the distribution, and then we can say that if they are similar or not by
yes,
we do CMEs.
Yes, that's what I am going to tell you, that why do we do CMEs. But before that, we are using a VAE, but we are not using VAE. VAE encoder part is anyways, and VAE is using a encoder part, and this encoder is nothing but a classification type of network. So as anyways, I have said that you can use an encoder. So this D is anyway the encoder, right? D is actually an encoder network. I have drawn it as well like this. It will take an image, convert it into a feature vector like DI1. But instead of training it with the reconstruction type of laws, you are training it as a discrimination, not the discriminator, but in the way of CMEs. You can train this encoder as classification, object detection, CMEs, or maybe reconstruction. All of them. This is actually what inception. This is what RCNN. This is what CMEs network or the face net or whatever the network that we are going to talk about. And this is VAE. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So same thing. Encoder is anyways going to be there. Anyone else who wanted to ask any question? Anything is not clear, then you can ask. Maybe if you have more questions in the next lecture before going to start from here, you can ask the questions. And in the next lecture, we are also going to talk about our Viva schedules. So I request all of you to get yourself prepared for your upcoming interactive Viva sessions, 10 minutes for each and every student, and there are going to be 3 such sessions, one after another, Friday and Saturday. First of our Viva is going to happen. In that Viva, you have to attend all of my lectures, maybe on YouTube, maybe whatever I have covered during the classes, whatever we have covered in the classes, exactly same things are going to be asked in our part A exam. Thank you.